Oh, you who believe, give charity for the pleasure of Allah, the pleasure of Allah. Oh, you who believe, read the Quran every night of Ramadan, night of Ramadan. Welcome, O Ramadan. It is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the mercy, and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show Ramadan, a date with Dr. Zakia. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we will be discussing the topic, Eid al-Fitr. Dr. Zakia, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Well, Dr. Zakia, yesterday, of course, we discussed the topic, Zakat al-Fitr, and we had a very interesting discussion about that subject and some questions from our viewers. And today we need to move on to Eid al-Fitr, which is a wonderful celebration for the Muslims. But I would very much like you now to define the term Eid.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shahli sadri wa yassirli amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. The word Eid means something which is habitual. It also means to return. It also means to repeat. In short, Eid means it is a recurring event. And it can also be used for a particular place which people visit periodically. It can also mean a time period where a particular act is done regularly. The plural of Eid is Ayad. It is a day of gathering. The Eid is derived from the Arabic word Adha, which means to return. And people return this event every year. That's Eid. And Ibn al-Arabi, he says that the reason Eid is called because it returns the happiness every year. And the word Eid, some people say, is also derived from Adha, which means the custom, which means tradition. So people accustomed to celebrating Eid, therefore the word Eid is there. According to Musnad Ahmad, volume number 3, hadith number 12006, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day enters the city of Medina, and before, in the days of Jahiliya, in the days of ignorance, the people of Medina used to celebrate 2 days of sports and amusement. One was the day of Nehruz, which was the new year. The other was the day of Maharajan, which was the final day of the year. So Prophet Muhammad says that you people in the days of Jahiliya used to celebrate 2 days with sports and amusement. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced it with 2 better days, the days of Nahar, that is the day of sacrifice, and the day of Fitr, that is the day of breaking, indicating the Eidain, the 2 Eid we have, Eid al-Adha and the Eid al-Fitr. They are replaced with the previous days of Jahiliya. So here we come to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replaced the days of Jahiliya, where people used to enjoy with play and amusement, with days that are better, the day of sacrifice, the day of forgiveness, etc., which is much better for them for this world as well as for the Akhirah.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. Well, Dr. Zakia, in the morning of the Eid, it's a requirement for the Muslims to go out and do the Eid prayer. Could you explain, for the benefit of myself and the viewers, what are the rulings regarding the Eid prayer?
As far as the prayer for Eid is concerned, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, in the Book of Fasting, hadith number 2534, Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that fasting is prohibited on 2 days. on Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. That means on the 2 days of Eidain, Eid al-Fitr, that breaking of the fast, any day of Adha, that is the Eid day of sacrifice. These 2 days is prohibited. So no one can fast on these 2 days. As far as the ruling is concerned about the Salah for Eid al-Fitr, there are differences of opinion amongst the scholars and the different schools of thought. According to Imam Shafi and Imam Malik, the Shafi's and the Malikis, they say that the Eid Salah is a sunnat-e-muqaddah. It is a very important sunnah known as mustahab. Based on the hadith that the Bedouin who comes and says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made us compulsory any salah other than the 5 prescribed salah, which is mentioned in Mughni, volume number 2, page number 223. So based on this hadith that no other salah is compulsory besides the 5 times prescribed salah, they say that this salah of Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, it is sunnat al-muqaddah. According to the Hanbali school of thought, the Hanbalis, they say it is farz-e kifaya. That means it's a farz, as long as some people from the community do it, it's enough. It's not farz on every individual, farz-e kifaya. And the third ruling, that is according to Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, he said that it is farz, it is wajib. And this view is also of Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, that praying Eid al-Fitr Salah and Eid al-Adha Salah, it is farz. And the ruling is based on the verse of the Quran of Surah Qawthar, chapter number 108, verse number 2, which says, إِنَّا أَتَيْنَاكَ الْقَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ means, and turn to the Lord in prayer and sacrifice. So it indicates that you have to offer the Eid Salah of Eid al-Adha and then sacrifice. So based on this verse, they say it is compulsory to offer the Eid Salah. And there are various other Sahih Hadith in which Prophet Muhammad has commanded the Muslims that they should offer Salah, not only to the general Muslims, even to the women who are menstruating. He said, go for Eid Salah, even if you don't have to offer Salah. He said, the veil woman, even the virgin, whether they are young or matured, they should go for Eid Salah. And the menstruating woman, even if they can't offer, they should at least go to the Musalla. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 351, as well as hadith number 324, and various other hadiths. The Prophet even said that the children should go. And based on this hadith, Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, and Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy on him too, they said that offering is Salah is fard. There's one more hadith in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1068, where the beloved Prophet Muhammad said that we have 2 Eids together. That is Eid al-Fitr and the Jummah Salah. Even Jummah is supposed to be a weekly Eid. So he says that after offering the Eid al-Fitr Salah, he says that those who do not want to offer Jummah Salah may not do it if they don't want to. But we will offer Jummah Salah. Indicating that because you offered Eid al-Fitr, Jummah Salah, which is more important than the 5 prescribed Salah. Here, Prophet said, if you offer Eid al-Fitr in congregation, Jummah Salah may not be offered that day. But naturally, they have to offer the normal Duhar Salah. So this surely indicates that Eid al-Fitr is a Farz Salah. And I agree with the view of Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, as well as Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy on him too.
Ameen, inshallah. And of course, it's such a wonderful opportunity for the Muslims to gather and, you know, feel good about themselves. And we need lots of opportunities to feel good about ourselves right now, inshallah. Dr. Zakir, could you explain when the Eid prayer is first allowed to be prayed early in the morning and when's the last time it can be prayed?
As far as the timing of the Eid Salah is concerned, it can be prayed any time after the sun rises approximately 3 meters above the horizon till it reaches the meridian. And majority of the scholars, they say that once the sun rises about the height of a spear above the horizon, that's to the naked eye but natural, and till the time it reaches the zenith, you can offer the prayer in between this. So before it reaches the zenith is the last time, and earliest time is after it rises from the horizon one spear above the height of the horizon. The hadith in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1131, Abdullah ibn Basr, he was one of the companions of the Prophet. He one day goes to offer Salah during the day of breaking of the fast or the day of sacrifice, offer the Eid Salah. And he disliked that the Imam, he delayed in offering the Eid Salah. And he said, at the time of the Prophet, at our times, by this time, the prayer used to end. That's in the forenoon. So praying early is preferable in the forenoon. And according to Ibn Qudama, who writes in his book Al-Mughni, in volume number 2, page number 224, he says that as far as Eid al-Adha is concerned, Eid of the sacrifice, it should be prayed as early as possible. After the sun rises, after one spear of height from the horizon, it should be prayed as early as possible because people have to go back home, they have to sacrifice, then later on they have to cook the food so that, you know, they can have the meal of the sacrifice by afternoon. And as far as the salah for Eid al-Fitr is concerned, it should be delayed so that people can give Zakat al-Fitr to those who are supposed to receive it, as the Prophet said, that give Zakat al-Fitr before the Eid Salah. So it's preferable to delay the Eid al-Fitr Salah. So this is a ruling as far as the timing of Eid Salah is concerned.
Jazakallah khair for the answer, Dr. Zakir. Could you explain to me what is the authentic method for performing the Eid prayer? And perhaps you would give us a short description for the benefit of the viewers watching today.
As far as Eid Salah is concerned, there are different types how Muslims pray, and there are different opinions. But as far as you go across authentic sources, the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, then you have one common method. And according to the authentic sources of all the Sahih Hadith, if you collect, we come to know that as far as the Eid Salah is concerned, whether it be Eid al-Fitr or Eid al-Adha, we have to offer two Salah, two Rakat Salah, two units of Salah. It's mentioned in the Hadith of Sunan Bayhaqi, volume number 3, book of Jummah Salah, Hadith number 5719, Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, radiallahu anhu, he said that the traveler's prayer is two rakat, the Adha prayer is two rakat, talking about Eid al-Adha, and the Jummah prayer is two rakat. This is the full length of all these prayers as it came from the Messenger of Allah. That means Eid Salah should be two rakat. Point number 2, that before Eid Salah, there is no Adhan and there is no Aqama. It's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1929, Jabir ibn Samura, he said that he prayed along with the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, both the Eids on more than one or two occasions, and there was no Adhan and no Aqama. That means for each Salah, there should be no Adhan and no Aqama. It's different than the normal congregation Salah. Point number 3, that there is no Salah before the Eid Salah and after the Eid Salah. There's no two rakah sunnah before or after that. And it's mentioned in the hadith of Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1155, where Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that the Prophet came out to pray the Eid Salah on Eid al-Fitr day, and he offered two rakat. And before that and after that, he did not pray. That means before and after Eid Salah, there are no other prayers. Further, point number 4, when a person starts the Eid Salah, he should say the Takbir al-Ihram, that's Allahu Akbar, and then say the open supplication. This is followed by 7 Takbir in the first rakat, and in the second rakat, he should say 5 Takbir. This we come to know from the authentic sources of Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1145 and 1146, where Hazrat Aisha, radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that the Prophet, when he used to offer the Eid al-Fitr Salah, and the Eid al-Adha Salah, that means Salah of both the Eid, he used to say 7 takbir in the first rakat and 5 takbir in the second rakat. This is the authentic way of offering Eid Salah. After that, a person should say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed, and in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. And then he should recite Surah Fatiha. And after Surah Fatiha, in the first rakat, recite Surah Qaf, chapter number 50, followed by in the second rakat, Surah Qamar, chapter number 54. Or in the first rakat, he can recite Surah Ala, chapter number 87, and second rakat, Surah Ghashiyah, chapter number 88. Both these types of first and second rakat have been proven from authentic hadith. But even if a person recites any other surah, any other verse of the Quran, yet the salah will be accepted. These are the recommended ones. It is sunnah which the Prophet recited. Furthermore, after the Eid Salah, there is a khutbah of the Eid Salah. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 962. Ibn Abbas, may Allah said that he has offered Eid Salah with the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Abu Bakr, with Umar, with Uthman, may Allah be pleased with them all. And all of them, they offered the Eid Salah first, then was followed by the khutbah. All of them, they gave the khutbah after offering the Eid Salah. It's further mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1151, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after offering Eid Salah and before starting the khutbah of Eid, he said that all those who want to listen to the khutbah can listen to the khutbah. All those who want to go, they can go. Now here is a very important point. Most of the times you find in the khutbah of Eid Salah, most of the imams say, they don't get up, it is wrong. And they prevent them from going and they say, you have a sin, and they say many things, it's haram to get up, etc. Imagine the Prophet Muhammad, when he gave the khutbah, he said, if you want to listen, you can listen. If you want to go, you can go. Does it mean that the imam, the khutbah that they give today is much more important than the khutbah of Prophet Muhammad? It's a pity. The Sahih Hadith says that the Prophet Muhammad said, if you want to hear the khutbah, you can hear. If you want, you can go. But it's preferable to hear the khutbah. But the Prophet gave permission that if they want, they can go. And further, it's mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 1068. The Prophet said that both the Eids have synchronized, the Eid al-Fitr and the Friday. Friday is called as a weekly Eid. So those who do not want to offer the Jummah Salah may not do it, because the Eid Salah in congregation is sufficient. But we will offer the Jummah Salah. That means, imagine, the Eid prayer is so important in congregation. So if it falls on the same day, Eid Salah is sufficient. Jummah Salah may not be prayed, but if you pray, it is good, alhamdulillah. But those who don't pray Jummah Salah, it becomes compulsory that they should pray the Duhar Salah. This was in short regarding the authentic way of offering the Eid Salah.
Okay, well, Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir. I'm sure that throws a lot of light on the absolute authentic method. As you say, there are many different people out there doing different things, and it'll be nice for us to do what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has recommended us to, indeed, inshallah. Dr. Zakia, could you explain the importance of women attending the Eid prayer, please?
As far as Eid Salah is concerned, it's compulsory for all the men to attend, and even the children, including the women, irrespective whether they're young or they're old, whether they're single, whether they're married, even if they're menstruating, the Prophet said they should attend, even though they don't have to offer Salah, they have to attend. And there are various hadith which speak about this. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 351, that Umme Atiya, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that we were ordered that all the women, even the menstruating women and the veiled women, they should go for Eid Salah, even though the menstruating women should keep away from Musalla. That means they should not offer Salah, that they should go. And when one woman asked the Prophet that, oh Prophet, what if a woman does not have a veil? So the Prophet replied, she should share the veil of a companion. That means she should borrow the veil from the companion. Even though she is not veiled, she should borrow. It is that important to attend the Eid congregation. And Umm Atiya continues and says that, may Allah be pleased with her, that we asked at least to attend the gathering and the invocation. You know, those menstruating women who cannot pray, at least they should attend the invocation and the gathering. It's further mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 975. Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that when he was a young boy, he went with the Prophet for the Eid Salah, and he says he doesn't remember whether it was Eid al-Adha or Eid al-Fitr. And after the Salah, the Prophet gave the sermon, and then he addressed the woman, and he preached to them, and he said that they should give alms, they should give charity. It further mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Menses, hadith number 324, that Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that we did not allow our virgin woman to go for each salah. And she continues. Then a lady comes and she says that my sister was the wife of one of the companions of the Prophet. And we used to attend to the soldiers during the fights in the battlefield. And she continues. And the Prophet said that the menstruating woman and the veiled woman should go for Eid Salah. And if she does not have a veil, she should borrow the veil from the companion. Later on, Umm Atiya, may Allah be pleased with her, she enters. So she asks her, that, have you heard so-and-so thing? So she said, yes. That's what the Prophet said, that even the menstruating woman and the matured virgin woman and the young virgin woman and the married woman, they should go for Eid Salah. And if the veiled woman does not have a veil, she should borrow the veil from a companion. So Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with us, menstruating woman? She said, yes. Don't they go at the Arafah? So they can go for invocation, they can go to attend the gathering, though they don't have to offer Salah. It's mentioned in Musannaf Ibn Shaybah, volume 2, hadith number 5786, that Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he is to take complete of his family for the Eid Salah. As much as of his family that he can take, he takes for the Eid Salah. So this shows that the women, they should go for the Eid Salah. Even if they're menstruating, if they cannot offer Salah, at least for the gathering and for the invocation.
Okay, thank you, Doctor. Now the next question, basically, what is the overall purpose of the Eid Salah?
As far as the purpose of the Eid Salah is, that Allah makes it on us that we should make our social lifestyle, that it should be seen that we believe in God consciousness, we believe in taqwa. And the best example that we have is the 5 times daily congregation salah. Muslims gather together and we show the taqwa that we have the God consciousness. People are aware of it. It's seen in our social life. The bigger gathering is the Jummah salah. And the biggest local gathering are the 2 Eid salah. And the largest annual gathering in the full world is the Hajj gathering. In the Hajj gathering, people from different parts of the world come together and they gather. But the local largest 2 gatherings are the 2 Salah for Eidain. That's the purpose. And secondly, the bigger gathering that we have, it shows our strength, the unity of the Muslims, and our love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our servitude. That is the reason Prophet said he should go to the Eidgah, so that there should be 1 big gathering rather than multiple small gatherings. So people will come to know the strength of the Muslims and it boosts up the morale of Muslims. Whoa, I didn't know that in 2 small villages, 50,000 Muslims. And for the non-believers, they'll think 10 times before making mischief. 50,000 Muslims. They'll think 10 times, they'll think 1,000 times before making mischief. So these also work on the psychology. And I feel that's very important. That is the reason the Prophet said, even the children, even the menstruating women should go, even if they cannot offer salah. So that the gathering is bigger and it's good. The unity of the Muslim Ummah is shown.
Yes, very beautiful to see the Muslims in such large gatherings on the Eid day. It really is beautiful. In London, we have huge gatherings in Central Mosque. I'm sure you may have been there.
Yes, I've been there several times.
What is the, in the position of a person who misses the congregational Eid Salah, what should he or she do in this case?
If a person misses Eid Salah, then he should offer the Eid Salah. And there is a chapter mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, chapter number 25, the heading of which is, if one misses the Eid congregation, what should he do? And it says that, it gives a reference of Anas bin Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, that he tells his slave that get all the family members, and he goes and then he offers the Eid Salah in the congregation. So all those who miss the Salah, whether men, women, they should offer it as soon as possible, and they can do it the same way as it was done earlier. And further it's mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the Book of Salah, hadith number 1153. There were a few people who came to the Prophet, peace be upon him. They came riding, and they said that yesterday we had seen the new moon. So the Prophet commanded that break your fast and offer your salah tomorrow. That means at the time where the Prophet was living, people hadn't seen the moon, so they continued fasting the 30th day. When some people come and give the shahada that they'd seen the moon yesterday, the Prophet immediately says that break the fast, because you cannot fast on Eid day. But since the time for Eid Salah has gone, offer Eid Salah tomorrow. That means if for certain reason, if it's a genuine reason, Eid Salah could not be offered, or you can even offer the next day. So this is the ruling as far as the person misses Eid Salah.
Dr. Zakir, how should the Muslims greet each other on the Eid day? And furthermore, are they allowed to say Eid Mubarak?
As far as greeting one another, it is recommended in the Sunnah that the Muslims should greet each other on the Eid day because it's a day of festival, etc. And according to Fatih al-Bari, volume number 2, page number 446, the Sahabas, the companions of the Prophet, whenever they met each other during Eid day, they used to wish each other by saying, Taqabbal Allahu minna wa minkum, meaning, may Allah accept it from us and you. Because Ramadan is the month of fasting, where people supplicate, they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they ask for forgiveness, they do du'as. So when the month is over, they pray that may Allah accept from us and from you. That's the best and authentic way of wishing each other. As far as saying Eid Mubarak, it is said more in India and Pakistan. It's a way of wishing each other congratulations. Mubarak means something of blessing. So Eid Mubarak means may it be a day of blessing. But it's more used as saying congratulations. So it is not a sunnah to wish each other Eid Mubarak, but neither is it haram or makruh. It will come in mubah category, optional. Because when you say something in English, you know, that may it be a blessing on you, there's no problem. So it is optional, but the right way of wishing each other is, as the Sahabas did, Taqabbal Allahu minna wa minkum, meaning may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us and you.
Okay, jazakallah khair. Next question, Dr. Zakir, is, could you explain what the recommended acts are on the day of Eid?
On the day of Eid, the first thing is that you should have ghusl. It's mentioned in Muwatta, page 240, hadith number 428. Nafi narrates, may Allah be pleased with him, that Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he used to have a bath, he used to have ghusl before proceeding for the Eid Salah. So it's a sunnah that you have to have a bath before going to the musalla for the Eid Salah. Number 2 is that it's also a sunnah that you should wear good clothes, adorn yourself, you should beautify yourself, you can wear new clothes, you can put coal in your eyes, put oil in the hair, you can wear perfume. But naturally all these things are for the men. The women are not recommended to wear perfume and adorn themselves when they go out, but naturally they should be in hijab. They should be veiled. This is talking about the men. Point number 3 is that the Prophet always had dates before he left his house for offering the Eid Salah. It's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, the Book of Two Eids, hadith number 953. The Prophet ate dates before he left the house for offering the Eid Salah. And the fourth act is that the Eid Salah should be offered in a musalla, in a place, maybe on a big ground, maybe in the town or on the outskirts of town, where all the people can gather in one place. It's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 956. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, on Eid day, he went to the Musalla and he offered the Salah. And offering Eid Salah in the Musalla is a Sunnah, rather than in the mosque. Though the Prophet's hadith is there, which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, the superiority of Masjid al-Harmain, Makkah and Medina, hadith number 1190, the Prophet said, praying in my mosque, that is praying in Masjid al-Nabwi, is better than offering 1,000 times Salah anywhere else, except Masjid al-Haram, that's Makkah. But yet, for the Eid Salah, the Prophet preferred leaving his own mosque and going to the Eidgah, going to the Musalla. That means, during Eid specifically, praying there is preferable than praying even in the mosque, even Masjid al-Nabwi. So this is the importance of praying in the Musalla. Furthermore, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 986. It says that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he should return back after offering Eid Salah to his home, he should return back in a way different from the way he had gone. That means the route of the Prophet going from the house to the Musalla was different and the route of coming back was different. And this was maybe because he wanted to give salam to the different people, you know, both the ways, and maybe the blessing would be two different types of people, and the various reasons given by people why he did that. Furthermore, it's very important that each salah should be prayed in the Musalla. As I mentioned earlier, the gathering is bigger, psychologically it's better, and we can, you know, show the God consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Further, it's the sunnah that we should go early to the Musalla. The earlier the better, you know, so that we can be in time, we hasten to do the good deed. It's also mentioned in the hadith of Tirmidhi, hadith number 530, that the Prophet, peace be upon him, he used to go on foot when he used to go to the Musalla. Offering each Salah, he used to go on foot. So it's sunnah to go walking, to offer your each Salah. And it's mentioned in the hadith of Silsila Sayyya, hadith number 171, that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he used to recite the takbir immediately after leaving home, till the time he reached the Musalla, till the time he finished his Salah, he used to say the takbir. And the most authentic talbiyah is what Ibn Masud had recited, mentioned in Dar al-Qutni and Ibn Shayba. He used to recite, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah wa Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. He used to recite, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, hu Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, meaning Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. There's no one worthy of worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. All praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the talbiyah and it should be recited the moment you leave the home till the time you read the salah, till the salah is to end, this talbiyah will recite Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are the few recommended acts that should be done during the Eid day.
Well, Jazakallah khair for your answer, Dr. Zakir. How far can a person go when they're celebrating Eid? I mean, are they permitted to sing and make amusement amongst themselves?
As far as singing and amusement during Eid day is concerned, as long as it is within the boundary of the Islamic Sharia, it's not overdoing oneself and should not go to things which are wrong, it's permissible. Within limits, within boundaries, it's permissible. And there are hadith speaking about that. The hadith of Sunan Nisa'i in the book of Eids, hadith number 1557, where Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the people of Medina in the Jahiliyyah, there are 2 days of play and amusement, of sports and amusement. Allah has replaced it with 2 days of amusement. That's the day of breaking of the fast and the day of sacrificing, talking about the two Idain. As far as singing is concerned, there is a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, the book of two Eids, hadith number 950, that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she narrates that it was the Eid day and the Negroes, they were playing and performing with their spears and their shields. So she asked Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked her, that, do you want to see? So she replies in the affirmative. And then she sees them, the Negroes performing, from behind the Prophet. And her cheek was touching the cheek of the Prophet. And then Prophet ﷺ says, oh, Bani Arfida, talking to the Negroes, that, come on, continue. And then she narrates, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be with her, I got tired. And the Prophet asks, are you satisfied? She again says in the affirmative, yes. And then he asks her to go. That means people did perform. The Negroes were performing with the shield and with the spear. So on the Eid day, it used to happen. There's another hadith mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 952, that during the Eid day, two young Ansari girls, they were singing some stories of the Ansar. When Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, he enters and he says, they're singing in the house of the Prophet, and he scolds them. Then Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, and he tells him that, let it be, it's the day of Eid. Let them continue. The same hadith is repeated, both the hadith joined together. It's repeated in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, in the book of Jihad, hadith number 2906, about the same incidents. So as long as it is within the limits, but natural, the instrument should not be haram instruments. It's mentioned in the other hadith that music instruments are haram, except if it's duff. Duff, which is permitted. That doesn't mean you can have string instruments and flute, etc. As we discussed earlier, that all these instruments are haram in Islam. Within the purview of the Islamic Sharia, if it's done, but natural, the singing should not be glorifying someone and, you know, making him lead to shirk, as some of the songs have. It should be within the purview of the Islamic Sharia. Some Islamic songs say no problem. Furthermore, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, in the book of two Eids, hadith number 2539 and 2540, that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that these are the days of Tashriq, you know, after Eid al-Adha, after the Eid of sacrifice, the 3 days that are there. These are the days of Tashriq, so eat and drink. So enjoying yourself, singing, amusement, as long as it is within the limits and a person does not go overboard, it's permissible.
Well, JazakAllah khair for your answer, Dr. Zakir. And I'd just like to ask you another question now. What are the common errors committed by Muslims whilst they're celebrating Eid?
There are some errors which are committed by many Muslims, some due to lack of knowledge, some due to ignorance. For example, there are many Muslims who think that if they pray in the night during Eid, if they pray the Salah, then the day when hearts die. This is actually a hadith which some people think it is sahih, but it's not so. That the Prophet said that if you pray in the night of the Eid, your heart will not die the day when hearts die. If you see, it has got two isnads. One of them is very weak, that is daif jiddan, and the other is daif. So it's totally wrong for anyone to pray during the night of the Eid thinking it will get him sawab. To single out that night only for praying is not allowed. Unless a person is habituated for praying in the night and then he prays, it's no problem. But to single out the Eid night only for prayer, it is wrong. Furthermore, there are some Muslims who visit graves during Eid, thinking it is good during Eid day. See, visiting grave according to the hadith of the Prophet, it reminds you of your akhirah. But to single out one particular day and visit the grave during that day, it is not recommended. There is no hadith which shows us that the Sahaba of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam visited the grave during Eid. To single out during Eid day to visit the grave, it's not there in the Sunnah of the Prophets. And furthermore, some people, they miss the Jama'ah, which is very wrong, and they miss the Salah during Eid day, which is totally wrong. As our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Hadith of Tirmidhi, Book of Faith, Hadith number 2621, where Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that the covenant between us and you is prayer. And anyone who forsakes it, is a kafir. So Salah is very important. Offering Jama'ah is important. Furthermore, that mistake that people make normally is that there's too much of intermingling of the sexes, men and women. Even when they go for Salah, they don't take care and we find men and women chatting with each other, they adorn themselves, the women, which is not right. Intermingling should be prevented. And for the places where Eid are offered, in the Eidgah, or if it's in a mosque, then it should be seen to it that there are separate entrances for the men and women. Equal but separate facility. So that this intermingling is avoided. Furthermore, there are some women who adorn themselves, who put perfume, who
who don't do hijab. Now, this should be avoided. When they come in front of an ahmeram, they should be in hijab. They should be properly covered. They should not wear perfume. They should not adorn themselves. They should not attract the opposite sex, the ahmeram. If they do it for the husband alone, it's good, alhamdulillah. If they do it amongst the women only, no problem. But for the ahmeram, it's not allowed. It's mentioned in the hadith of Sunan Nisa'i, hadith number 5129, where the beloved Prophet said that any woman who wears perfume and passes so that people may smell her perfume, if she wears the perfume and people smell her perfume, it's as good as she is an adulteress. So these things should be avoided. Further, some of the Muslims, women, each day comes, they watch movies, they hear songs, they sing, they dance, they play musical instruments, and all these things are nothing but kutu'atu shaitan. You know, watching un-Islamic movies, listening to un-Islamic songs, etc. As our beloved Prophet ﷺ said, it mentioned Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, in the Book of Drinks, hadith number 5590, the Prophet said that there will be a time when there'll be some people from my ummah who will say that illegal sexual intercourse, drinking intoxicants, wearing silk, and playing of musical instruments are halal, is legal. So we have to be careful that we should not be amongst these people. And one more point to be noted is that many of the Muslims, they're happy that Ramadan is over. Oh, now we don't have to fast, you know, as though fasting was a burden. But they're happy because they don't have to fast, they don't have to fast. Rather, they should be happy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them complete the month of Ramadan, made them fast. That should be right, because fasting is worship. They should be happy for that, that they were able to complete, rather than be happy that it was something burden which they finished. So these things Muslims should avoid.
Final question today, Dr. Zakia, relates to where the Muslims should pray their Eid prayer. Is it compulsory for them to pray it at the Eidgah, or are they allowed to pray it in the mosques too?
As far as the Sunnah of the Prophet is concerned, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he always commanded that as far as the Eid Salah is concerned, of both the Eid, it should be offered in the Musalla, it should be offered in the Eidgah. Eidgah is the word used in India, Pakistan, the Arabic word is Musalla. It's mainly an open ground so that more people can gather. So one town or one city, there should be as least gathering as possible and bigger gathering. So it should be one Musalla, means one place where a person prays for the full town. That's preferable, or as least number of places, maximum number of gathering. It's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Two Eid, hadith number 956. It says the Prophet, during the Eid day, he went and prayed in the Musalla. And there are various hadith which we discussed earlier, that in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, hadith number 324, the Prophet commanded the women, the children, the menstruating women to go to pray in the Eidgah. According to the Aimas, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah have mercy on them all of them said that going to the Eidgah is a requirement. It's a must, unless there's a necessity, except for Imam Shafi, may Allah have mercy on him. Imam Shafi, he said that if the mosque is big to accommodate all the people, then you can pray in the mosque. But even he said, if the mosque is not big to accommodate all the people, then preferable is a musalla, that is the Eidgah. So the preferable thing is Eidgah. And the Prophet, for the Eid Salah, even though the general ruling is according to Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the Book of Priorities of Praying in the Masjid al-Harmain, Makkah and Medina, hadith number 1190, the Prophet said that praying in my mosque, Masjid al-Nabwi, is 1,000 times better than praying in any other mosque except Masjid al-Haram, Masjid al-Makkah. In spite of this, he preferred Eidgah. That showed the superiority during Eid Salah only. And unfortunately, nowadays, most part of the world, hardly we find, there are people who praying in grounds, but very few. What we should have is one place. Can't we have one big park for the Eid Salah and all pray together, or hire two parks in the full city and gather all the Muslims together? Unfortunately, we don't have that. Even in Bombay, there are very few places where they offer in big grounds, but majority are in the mosque. So preferably it should be in a ground, as less number of places to pray, and bigger the gathering it should be. Unless there is a requirement, whether the hadith in Mustadrak al-Hakim, in the Book of Salatul Idain, hadith number 1094, one day during Eid, because it was raining, the Prophet prayed in the mosque. So if there is a reason like raining, snowing, etc., and then you pray in the mosque, it's fine. Otherwise, it's preferable to pray in the Eidgah.
So, Dr. Zakir, Jazakallah khair once again for all your useful answers on the topic of Eid al-Fitr. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a good Eid and an accepted Ramadan.
Ameen.
As all the Muslims.
Qabbala minna minkum. May Allah accept it from us and you.
Inshallah. Ajma'in, inshallah. And that, of course, we've almost come to the end of our scheduled shows on Ramadan, a date with Dr. Zakir as well. So this is almost a small Eid for us in itself. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your Eid and all your righteous deeds and all the good answers that you've given us today. Jazakallah khair. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, do join us again tomorrow at the same time when we will be discussing voluntary fasts and prohibited fasts. Jazakallah khair for watching. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
حافظين ذاكرين قانتين خاشعين مسلمين مؤمنين للإله عابدين شهرنا صوم وعتق وقنوت فيه صدق يومنا صبر ورفق بدموع البائسين رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطل مسعدا أهلا وخلا لتوبة